Good afternoon, Coppin State University faculty, students, family, and friends. I am Abena Lewis Moon, advisor of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society in the Department of Humanities Program of History and African American Studies. I'm delighted that you are here with us, virtually, of course, to witness this special occasion today. This afternoon, we will induct five history students into the Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society, immediately followed by the annual Chester W. Gregory Sr. Colloquium. I would like to invite Dr. Catherine Bencole Medina, distinguished faculty scholar and coordinator of the History and African American Studies program here at Coppin State University, to welcome you to our Phi Alpha Theta Honor History Honor Society induction today. Dr. Bencole Medina.
Hello and welcome to the annual Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society induction ceremony, of course, in virtual format. As you know, I am Dr. Catherine Bencole Medina, professor of history here at Coppin State University. And I just want to say that we are so pleased to present to you history scholars who demonstrate academic excellence, social responsibility, and integrity. We thank everyone who supported this programming effort, and a special Phi Alpha Theta thank you goes to all of the CSU faculty and administration that support the advancement of the discipline of history. I'm going to turn our program back over to Dr. Abena Lewis Moon, Associate Professor of History and Faculty Advisor for Phi Alpha Theta at Coppin State University. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bencole Medina. While our Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society induction will look different this year, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, we will forge ahead. Last year, we were not able to have an induction ceremony due to the progression of COVID-19 and the uncertainties surrounding the abrupt period of quarantine. Therefore, our president of the Alpha Alpha Nu chapter of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society graduated. So I will have the distinct honor today of presiding and fulfilling the president's role. Phi Alpha Theta is an American honor society for undergraduate, graduate students, and professors of history. The society has over 400,000 members with 9,000 new members joining each year in over 970 chapters nationwide. Phi Alpha Theta was established on March 17, 1921 at the University of Arkansas by Professor Niels Klevin. Klevin had become convinced that a fraternity of scholars, which included both men and women, was important for the study of history. He invited students to a meeting to form the society. And on March 17, 1921, Phi Alpha Theta was born. The Alpha Alpha Nu chapter of Phi Alpha Theta was established at Coppin State University on September 24, 1982. Our chapter abides by the mission of Phi Alpha Theta to promote the study of history through the encouragement of research, good teaching, publication, and the exchange of learning and ideas amongst historians. We seek to bring students and teachers together for intellectual and social exchanges which promote and assist historical research and publication. The students being inducted into Phi Alpha Theta today understand that centering identity allows for a more nuanced understanding of history, especially in today's climate with the unspeakable amount of trauma and violence inflicted on people of color and the warfare against Black bodies. It is imperative that our students at Coppin State University understand their agency and their ability to make change. No matter how uncomfortable the conversations are, each of these students are able to connect historical topics learned in the classroom and implement ideas and strategies to create tools to demand equity and inclusivity to tell our stories. It is unfortunate that you may be faced with pushback about the study of history, even here at your own beloved Coppin State University. You see, many schools don't understand the significance or see the value in learning, researching, understanding, and then presenting history to the public. I applaud each of you for pushing forward, holding on to the love that you have for learning history and understanding that your cultural competency has the potential to impact the masses. Keep reading, keep researching, keep doing your important historical work. You are the minds that will move us forward. We will now begin our virtual initiation ceremony. Since you as students of human thought and action have expressed a desire to continue upon high paths of history, and since your predecessors have found you worthy to share such privileges, it is with pleasure that we initiate you into the Alpha Alpha Nu chapter of Phi Alpha Theta, a society dedicated to the service of history. Before the beginning of history, time stretched back through unknown eons. The future lies ahead in equally unknown vistas. Within the immense span of eternity, historic time is only a very brief period. Now, the study of the past may be divided into six great ages. Of these, four have disappeared, having left everlasting impressions on civilizations. The fifth age is the present, while the last, the future, lies ahead to be known and judged by generations yet unborn. We'll begin with the prehistoric age.
I am the spokesperson for the prehistoric age. In the prehistoric age, societies were formed as people learned to make fire, improve their tools and weapons, domesticate animals, raise cereals, weave coarse cloth, construct crude permanent shelters, create art, and develop religious expressions. As their numbers increased, they evolved larger and more complex societies with institutions of government. With the introduction of agriculture and the commencement of trade, people created a system of enduring human relationships. when at last they learned to record their deeds and desires in writing, they passed from the prehistoric to the ancient age.
Okay. I am the spokesperson for the ancient age. In the ancient age, early societies in China, India, the Middle East, the Mediterranean world, the Americas, and Africa built cities and created powerful states and empires, which were sustained by command over the natural environment and the ordering of society. With steadily increasing religious, political, and economic specialization, social hierarchies appeared. Through reason and conjecture, the conceptual realms of religion, ethics, philosophy, and science developed. Through the inspiration and teachings of the philosophers and prophets, people learned to understand and transcend the beauty and inequities of life, and to perceive the order permeating the universe. In the latter centuries of the ancient age, the great empires of the world experienced political, social, and economic change in the face of numerous challenges. With the collapse of dynasties, the decline of empires, and the fall of civilizations, the ancient world has passed away.
I am the spokesperson for the early modern age. During the 400 years of this age, national states arose in Europe, America, Africa, Asia, and the Pacific, and societies divided into an increasing number of social classes. Capitalism, emerging from its primitive beginnings, became a dominant feature of Western civilization. Contact was established between isolated continents of the world and in successive waves of imperialism. Europeans carried both the virtues and vices of their civilization to all corners of the globe. In the wake of these enlarged activities came revolutions in ideas, institutions, and practices. No aspect of life, religion, family structure, economic activity, political systems, or culture was left untouched. Great progress was made in material benefits, but often this was at the expense of the significant dislocation of human lives, the suppression of people, the ravaging of natural environments, cultural tensions and resentments between peoples, and the intensification of ideological conflicts. Further concentration on material well-being led to a growing secularization of society. All of these developments would pose serious challenges for the world during the contemporary age.
I am the spokesperson for the contemporary age. At the beginning of the contemporary age, it seemed that the ideals of democracy would soon be achieved throughout the world, and that the horrors of war, which had haunted humanity since the beginning of recorded time, would soon be ended forever by an era of perpetual peace and international cooperation. These hopes were dashed by two world wars and numerous smaller conflicts, which resulted in untold misery and serious economic and social dislocations. Nevertheless, the contemporary age has been rich in spiritual values and has had a great thirst for reform and civil rights. People have practiced humanitarianism on a scale greater than anything known in any other era. And that the horizons of human understanding and learning have been widened immeasurably. Globally, great problems still exist. Bitter ethnic feuds, new outbreaks of racism, continuing concerns about sexual discrimination, barbaric violations of human rights, and more devastating machines of war, ecological challenges of the greatest magnitude, and the dehumanizing effects of certain modern technologies. In the midst of these tensions, the historian believes that individuals and nations may approach nearer to the ideal of harmonizing responsibility with freedom through the study of the human experience of the past, which will afford content and wisdom for our lives in the future age.
We are all the spokespeople for the future age. You have now passed through five ages of the past, and where that path leads in the future, no one can predict. The pessimists may be right. Tensions among nations and power blocks, backed by new material and technological advances, could bring about the destruction of civilized society. The previous ages have demonstrated that nationalism, racism, and sex discrimination are long-enduring problems. Therefore, they must be monitored constantly until permanent yet unknown solutions are evolved. The pessimist sees this delay into the distant future, but the optimist sees it as just over the horizon, where the human race may succeed in producing a civilization immeasurably more peaceful and finer than any the world has yet seen. An age in which may be realized the highest ideal of universal humanity. It is toward this great goal that the historian should constantly strive. To you, worthy students of history, this challenge is offered so that in part through your own efforts, the future may become the world's greatest age. Monica Green, you will be expected to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha Theta. The spirit of respect inculcates a sincere regard for the rights of each individual to freedom, the belief in the community of all persons, which renders abhorrent all ideas that foment national hatred, racial and sexual discrimination, and all forms of injustice. You are expected to abide by the invaluable lessons learned from the study of history and hold fast to the need for historians to search for truth and to accept the responsibility for making decisions in terms of their meaning for others as well as yourself. Monica Green, do you accept the challenge of striving to live up to these ideals of Phi Alpha Theta?
Yes, I do accept the challenge.
Thank you. Sania Johnson, you will be expected to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha. The spirit of respect inculcates a sincere regard for the rights of each individual to freedom, the belief in the community of all persons, which renders abhorrent all ideas that foment national hatred, racial and sexual discrimination, and all forms of injustice. You are expected to abide by the invaluable lessons learned from the study of history and hold fast to the need for historians to search for truth and to accept the responsibility for making decisions in terms of their meanings for others as well as yourself. Sania Johnson, do you accept the challenge of striving to live up to these ideals of Phi Alpha Theta?
Yes, and my name is Sania Johnson, not Sania.
I apologize, Sania. Thank you for correcting me. Sania Johnson, do you accept the challenge of striving to live up to these ideals of Phi Alpha Theta?
Yes, I do accept.
Thank you. April Lee, you will be expected to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha Theta. The spirit of respect inculcates a sincere regard for the rights of each individual to freedom, the belief in the community of all persons, which renders abhorrent all ideas that foment national hatred, racial and sexual discrimination, and all forms of injustice. You are expected to abide by the invaluable lessons learned from the study of history and hold fast to the need for historians to search for truth and to accept the responsibility for making decisions in terms of their meanings for others as well as for yourself. April Lee, do you accept the challenge of striving up to these ideals of Phi Alpha Theta?
Yes, I do accept the challenge.
Thank you. Sabria Poole, you will be expected to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha Theta. The spirit of respect inculcates a sincere regard for the rights of each individual to freedom, the belief in the community of all persons, which renders abhorrent all ideas that foment natural hatred, racial and sexual discrimination, and all forms of injustice. You are expected to abide by the invaluable lessons learned from the study of history and hold fast to the need for historians to search for truth and to accept the responsibility for making decisions in terms of their meaning for others as well as yourself. Ms. Poole, Sabria Poole, do you accept the challenge of striving to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha Theta?
I accept.
Thank you. And finally, Brianna Valentine, you will be expected to live up to the ideals of Phi Alpha Theta. The spirit of respect inculcates a sincere regard for the rights of each individual to freedom, the belief in community of all persons, which renders abhorrent all ideals that foment national hatred, racial and sexual discrimination, and all forms of injustice. You are expected to abide by the invaluable lessons learned from the study of history and hold fast to the need for historians to search for truth and to accept the responsibility for making decisions in terms of their meaning for others as well as yourself. Brianna Valentine, do you accept the challenge of striving to live up to these ideals of Phi Alpha?
I accept. I accept. I accept.
I would like to welcome our newly initiated members of the Alpha Alpha Nu chapter of Phi Alpha Theta at Coppin State University. Congratulations. Because we are virtual, you will receive your Phi Alpha Theta membership, certificate, ceremonial gifts, and special history and African American studies program treats by mail. Again, congratulations to our history students on their significant accomplishment. Each year, Phi Alpha Theta selects a student scholar that epitomizes the values and goals of the History and African American Studies program at Coppin State University. This year's winner, in spite of various challenges faced by the COVID-19 pandemic, has continued to dedicate herself to asking difficult questions, searching diligently to unearth answers, and sharing her findings in compelling ways. It is my honor to present April Lee with the Alpha Alpha Nu Chapter of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society, Fanny Jackson Coppin's Distinguished Students Awards for Academic Excellence. Congratulations, April Lee.
Thank you.
We will now have remarks by Dr. Catherine Bencole Medina, coordinator of the History and African American Studies program, immediately followed by a brief transition into the Chester W. Gregory Sr. Colloquium, where our keynote speaker, Dr. Teisha Dupree-Wilson, will engage us in the exciting topic of the historical evolution of the Black family in media. Dr. Bencole Medina.
Thank you, Dr. Lewis Moon. My closing remarks will be brief so that we can move on to our annual Chester Gregory Symposium. I want to thank all of our inductees. Congratulations to all of you. I want to thank all of the panelists as well. Thank you to all of our speakers, our presenters. And I can talk more if you like, but I'm not going to do that today. I'm going to be as brief as possible. But I did want to share with you that the study of history has been one of the greatest pursuits of my life. I have learned to strive for excellence and impeccability. I have learned to be humble and honest and clear about all that I do not know. I have learned to never stop researching knowledge and information that clarifies the past and defines our future. As our newest members of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society, you join legions of scholars across generations dedicated to understanding and preserving the past. Remember that you represent the discipline of history, so let your good name always speak the truth. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon again, students, faculty, family, and friends. I want to thank you for joining us today for the 13th Annual Chester W. Gregory Sr. Colloquium. Last year, the Chester Gregory program was abruptly canceled due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and so it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here today. I am Abena Lewis Moon, History and African American Studies Program faculty in the Department of Humanities. I would first like to recognize our newly inducted members of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society, Monica Green, Sunia Johnson, April Lee, Sabria Poole, and Brianna Valentine. It is always so fitting that we begin the Chester Gregory Colloquium honoring high-achieving young history scholars because Dr. Gregory valued academic achievement and dedicated himself to researching and writing historical scholarship and sharing his knowledge. I would now like to welcome Dr. Larry Martin, Chair Emeritus of the Chester W. Gregory Senior Colloquium and former Chair of the Department of History, Geography, and Global Studies here at Coppin State University to bring the statement of occasion and provide insight on Dr. Gregory, the Chester Colloquium, and the prevailing reason we are virtually gathered this afternoon. And I'd like to quickly make a correction. Dr. Martin could not be with us today for health reasons. And so Dr. Lopez Matthews has agreed to share comments from Dr. Martin. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Matthews on behalf of Dr. Martin. Thank you, Dr. Matthews. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Lewis Moon. I am Lopez Matthews, Jr., adjunct professor in the Department of Humanities here at Coppin State University, and also a graduate of the program. So I'm happy to step in for Dr. Martin today, and I will read his prepared statement. And it's greetings. I am presenting to you a statement of the occasion for this colloquium program on behalf of Dr. Larry L. Martin, who is unable to be with us today. Dr. Martin, now retired, was a member of the Department of History, Geography, and Global Studies here at Coppin, and was one of the founding members of what is now the annual Chester W. Gregory Sr. Colloquium. Dr. Chester W. Gregory Sr., now deceased, in whose honor this colloquium is named, was professor of history at Coppin State University from 1969 to 1994. During his tenure at Coppin, he was chairperson of the Division of Social Sciences from 1969 to 1974, and was for a period of time chairperson of the Department of History, Geography, and Global Studies, and full professor until his retirement in 1994. As an academician with a sound scholarly knowledge base, Dr. Gregory had a productive career with more than 40 years of experience in teaching, research, and writing. He taught courses in American history, American foreign policy, European history, history of Africa, geography, history of women, world history, Latin American history, the Middle East, and other subjects. His publications were quite extensive, and it is noteworthy that he was one of the pioneering historians to focus on African American history, gender studies, religious history, and Black business history. In 2007, the Department of History, Geography, and Global Studies at Coppin State University established the Chester Woodrow Gregory Sr. Colloquium. The colloquium is an initiative that recognizes the research and scholarly commitment to academic excellence, which personified Dr. Gregory as a distinguished historian. Additionally, the colloquium recognizes Dr. Gregory's generosity in establishing an endowment which promotes scholarly historical studies and activities for department majors. Each year, the colloquium is held during the week of and in conjunction with the university-wide excellence celebration. As I continue to reflect upon Dr. Gregory's life, I am reminded that he applied his beliefs of Christian principles to every aspect of his living. I see parallels between the lives of Drs. Gregory and Dr. Cargbo in this regard. Dr. Cargbo was a former professor of history here at Coppin State University as well, who has also unfortunately passed away. Dr. Gregory nurtured his academic studies in the field of history and allied subjects, and he also nurtured his spiritual life. A devout church attendee, he used his intellect to publish two full-length books on the United Holy Church of America. Dr. Gregory's initiatives as a teacher extended beyond the classroom in helping students to succeed. An example would be that each year he would use his personal car and drive students to the annual graduate recruitment affair at The Ohio State University in Columbus. This he did without compensation, and it is noteworthy that several of the students who accompanied Dr. Gregory were accepted for graduate study and received graduate degrees. In closing, let me say on behalf of the members of the Program of Study in History, we remember Dr. Gregory as a collegial gentleman and scholar. We see him as a distinguished academician, as a role model in various regards, a role model for his easy, congenial, and supportive manner, a role model who exemplified excellence in his educational pursuits, and a role model as a man who loved God and respected and treated his fellow man with respect and dignity. So with that, I will close. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Matthews, for bringing greetings and sharing the occasion on behalf of Dr. Larry Martin. Thank you, Dr. Matthews. We will now have greetings by Dr. Seth Forrest, Chair of the Department of Humanities at Coppin State University. Dr. Forrest.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lewis Moon. Thank you, colleagues, for preparing this wonderful occasion today. Thank you, students, for your hard work. It's a real pleasure. It's an honor for me to be able to share this day with you, where we recognize things that we should recognize every day, and that is that our historians and their students at Coppin State are regularly among the most prodigious, the best published scholars on campus. The work that they do is obviously invaluable in this world where we deal with so many continued injustices. It's my pleasure to be presenting a greeting once again. I'm really honored, and I have been for more than 10 years now, to be allowed to be a professor at Coppin State University. As part of my greeting today, the only thing I regret is that I'm not able to be with everyone in person. I know that after a year of doing everything virtually, that we're all a bit starved for real human contact. And that's the only regret that I would share today among a host of pleasures and proud feelings. In greeting today, I wanted to share with everyone a poem. I am by trade a poetry scholar in the English program. And there's a piece of poetry that I've sort of kept in my mind over the past few months. It's something that I've come back to reading this again and again, and really considering how its message is getting me through this sort of difficult season of life. It's by Lucille Clifton, who you may or may not know, was a Coppin State professor briefly in the early 70s. This poem is called Cutting Greens, and it's very likely that she wrote this poem while she worked at Coppin, maybe even in one of the offices at Grace Jacobs Hall that we're feeling pretty anxious to get back to. I think this poem, it sort of does the work of poetry excellently, and it really rhymes, if I may say, with the sentiments that were expressed throughout the induction ceremony that we just witnessed. So this is Cutting Greens by Lucille Clifton. Curling them around, I hold their bodies in obscene embrace, thinking of everything but kinship. Collards and kale strain against each other. Away from my kiss-making hand and the iron bed pot. The pot is black, the cutting board is black, my hand, and just for a minute, the greens roll black under the knife, and the kitchen twists dark on its spine and I taste in my natural appetite the bond of live things everywhere. In some ways, it's an odd little poem, but that last two lines just for me have been a thing to come back to and to think about in terms of the way that I study literature, in terms of the great gifts that being part of the Coppin family have continued to give me over 10 years, the feeling of the bond of live things everywhere. If that's not what we do in humanities, to strive to make that feeling something that we experience every day, then I'm not sure what it is we do. But that's my greeting. Take poetry and the study of things that matter to you out into the day. Thanks for letting me be here, and thanks for everyone.
That was beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Forrest, for your greetings, and thank you for sharing that wonderful poem. I think it was very fitting, and your comments around it were also very fitting and complement everything that we're doing here today. So thank you, Dr. Forrest. We will now be greeted by Dr. Catherine Bancole Medina, Distinguished Faculty Scholar and Coordinator of the History and African American Studies Program. Dr. Bancole Medina.
Thank you, Dr. Lewis Moon. I want to thank Dr. Forrest for that wonderful selection from Lucille Clifton. That was just awesome and so, so appropriate. I want to thank Dr. Lopez Matthews for bringing us Dr. Larry Martin's greeting. For those of you who never got a chance to meet Dr. Martin, he's such a gracious individual. And he's an elder who in our community is most revered and most respected. So I appreciated his statement. I know he took time with it. I know because he's such a perfectionist. And Dr. Lopez Matthews, I also want to thank you for raising the name of Dr. Ibrahim Kargbo. He was such a tremendous scholar. There's not a day that goes by that I don't think of him over the last 13 years I have been here. I think of Dr. Kargbo. He was a colleague's colleague. He was a scholar par excellence, and he is so missed, but yet so appreciated by all of us. Now, I'm not going to give a presentation as much as I would like to, and as much as I like to talk, I'm not gonna do any of those things. I will say that the life and legacy of Chester Gregory Sr. is so important now more than ever before. Dr. Gregory was part of that great scholarly legacy of Black men and women who had their humanity constantly challenged, and they struggled on behalf of their people. They define an intellectual movement that continues to enrich and enhance our lives. We carry on their tradition with pride and with certainty. Our guest speaker, Dr. Teisha Dupree-Wilson, continues bravely in this intellectual tradition of our ancestors. So with that, I will just say thank you as we move our program forward. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Bancole Medina. It is now my distinct honor to welcome our Chester W. Gregory Senior Colloquium keynote speaker, who will tell us why representation matters as she discusses the historical evolution of the Black family in media. Dr. Teisha Dupree-Wilson is an assistant professor of history at Coppin State University. She's a native of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and received her bachelor's degree in history from Howard University. Dr. Dupree-Wilson went on to obtain her law degree from Northwestern California University School of Law. Her law school trial and appellate advocacy thesis entitled "The Conscience of the Community, Race, Gender, and Jury Nullification in the Criminal Justice System," examined the history of racism against African Americans in convictions and sentencing in the U.S. court system. During her time in the legal field, she worked for two private law firms before accepting an appointment with the U.S. Department of Justice and later the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission. Although Dr. Dupree-Wilson spent many years in the field of law, she recognized that her professional calling was tied to her never-ending passion for history. This led her to pursue a career in history through museums and academia. She went on to earn her master's degree and PhD in history from Morgan State University in Baltimore. Her doctoral work highlights the impact and the influence of Philadelphia's Black radio stations and disc jockeys during the era of the Civil Rights Movement. Dr. Dupree-Wilson's current research focuses on the role of the African-American media in covering and encouraging civil rights activism and the impact of Black lawyers during the era of Jim Crow. She is the recipient of awards, including a diversity fellowship with the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture. She also served as the educational coordinator for the Lily Carroll Jackson Civil Rights Museum here in Baltimore. And she is a proud member of Phi Alpha Theta National History Honor Society, the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, the Association of Black Women Historians, the Association of African American Museums, Phi Delta Phi International Law Fraternity, the National Council of Negro Women, and Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, just to name a few. Dr. Dupree-Wilson's most recent publications include Killing Dixie, the NAACP, the Black Press, and the Crusade to End Black Caricature Culture in Hollywood, and Phenotypic Proximity, Colorism and Interracial Discrimination Among Blacks in the United States and Brazil. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Teisha Dupree-Wilson as she brings the 2021 annual Chester W. Gregory Sr. Colloquium keynote address, Representation Matters, the Historical Evolution of the Black Family in Media. Dr. Dupree-Wilson, welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Lewis Moon, for the introduction. I'm honored to be here with you all today, students and colleagues. And I just want to shout out again our students that were inducted into Phi Alpha Theta. We don't take your hard work for granted, and we appreciate all that you do. When you go out into the world, you represent Coppin State University, and you do it so well. So thank you, thank you, thank you, and congratulations again. All right, so we're gonna do some TV history today. So I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen. Let's see. Okay. So I'm going to do 71 years of history in 15 minutes. You think we can handle it? All right, so let's get into it. Representation Matters, the Historical Evolution of the Black Family in Media from 1950 to present. So during the early years of television, Black families and Black people in general craved representation on television. Unfortunately, during the early years of TV, Black characters emerged in a way that perpetuated myths and stereotypes about Black life. And a lot of the roles that you're gonna see on television during this time are gonna include slaves, servants, and jungle characters. Two of the first African-American sitcoms to emerge are gonna be Beulah in 1950 and Amos and Andy in 1951. Once again, these two shows did not show African-Americans in the best light. It was buffoonish, slapstick comedy that basically made African-Americans look like minstrels. And a lot of people really opposed these shows. In addition to that, you had Tarzan come out in 1966 on NBC that not only made African people look terrible, but it made Africa look like this place that no one wanted to be affiliated with. So these shows were very problematic for Black families. People tuned in to see positive images, and that is not what they got. So television is going to evolve, but again, nothing is going to happen during the civil rights movement without pressure, right? So you're going to see the advent of the civil rights, the modern civil rights movement in the 1950s, where people were going to seek to challenge the disparate treatment of African Americans in all arenas. So the Black press and the NAACP are going to come together to champion causes related to the Black freedom struggle. But one of the things that they really wanted to do was to transform Hollywood into this place where African Americans can be seen in a positive light. Because the thing is, if you're watching television and all you see are negative images of yourself all day long, or if you're not a Black person and the only visuals that you have of Black people are on television and it's not a positive one, it's going to impact your mindset. So the NAACP, the Black press, and Black Americans felt as though they could help Black actors, because some Black actors just wanted to have a job, right? But some of them felt that it did a disservice to the race by continuing to play these roles on television. So let's talk about Walter White of the NAACP. Now, Walter White served as the executive secretary for the NAACP from 1931 to 1955. One of the things that he really loved to do was to combat negative imagery on camera, not just in television, but films as well. Now, I don't know if you guys can see his picture, because I think this is in the way. Can you see it? So he's a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Black man. And he believed that the NAACP could assist Black actors in Hollywood. It wasn't that he felt as though people shouldn't play maids on television, because Black people were maids, but he felt as though the race had more to offer than just showing Black people in domestic roles. So he established a constant presence in Hollywood, where basically he told the studios, before anything goes to production, I need to see the script if there's a Black person in the movie. They were afraid of Walter White. So whenever there was a movie, even if there was only one or two Black characters, he had to sign off on the script. In addition to Walter White and the NAACP, the African-American press is going to emerge, and they're basically going to be the Kobe Bryant to the NAACP Shaquille O'Neal. It's gonna be a 1-2 type punch, right? So you're gonna see Black newspapers, the Chicago Defender, Pittsburgh Courier, the New York Amsterdam News, the Philly Tribune, and the Afro-American in Baltimore tirelessly attack Hollywood over negative imagery. And later on, Ebony and Jet magazines are going to get involved as well. And guess what? It's going to work, because we're going to get new shows where African-Americans are being depicted in a positive light. So let's talk about I Spy. I Spy was a show that premiered in 1965, starring Bill Cosby on the left and Robert Culp on the right. They were undercover agents for the federal government, and it provided middle-class white America with a glimpse into the life of a Black person who was not a servant, because Bill Cosby's character was not subservient to Robert Culp's character. They were equals. And in most instances, Bill Cosby's character was like the brains of the duo. But during the show's run, they wanted to use stunt doubles for Bill Cosby that appeared in blackface, basically have a white man paint himself Black and play the stunt double to Bill Cosby. Bill Cosby said, absolutely not. So because of his protests, Bill Cosby himself created the Black Stuntmen's Association, because he refused to have a white stunt double be polished up in blackface. Because of Bill Cosby's activism on this issue, it created the Black Stuntmen's Association that still exists today. So a year later, we're gonna get more positive Black representation on television. Black families are going to run to the television to catch an episode of Star Trek, okay? Star Trek is going to show the first African-American female character on television that will appear in a non-stereotypical servant role. Lieutenant Uhura, played by the iconic actress Nichelle Nichols, will be the communications director of the Starship Enterprise. So her character depicted her too as the brains of the operation and equal to her white counterparts. She possessed intelligence and dignity. and she was encouraged by Dr. King to continue in the role. She was going to quit the show and go to Broadway and do live shows. Dr. King saw her at a function and said, "You're not quitting. Black girls need to see you on television because of the positivity that you bring to these roles." And enter Julia in 1968. So the Julia Show is another major achievement in television for African-American families. This appeared on NBC television, and it became the first show to star an African-American woman in a non-stereotypical leading role. Julia was a nurse, she was a professional, and a strong and intelligent middle-class Black woman. And she was played, of course, by the legendary second to none, Diane Carroll. TV producers wanted to create this show because they attended an NAACP fundraiser where Roy Wilkins and others talked about the importance of showing positive Black families on television. So here with Julia, we get a positive, strong, single African-American mother raising her son after her husband was killed in the Vietnam War. And after Julia, again, you're gonna see more Black representation on television. Of course, Mission Impossible is gonna debut featuring Greg Morris, Mod Squad featuring Clarence Williams III. I try so hard not to refer to him as Prince's dad from Purple Rain, but I can't help myself. I always do it. But Clarence Williams III is gonna star as Link Hayes. And really the character of Link is really kind of a nod to the Black Power movement that was at its all-time high in 1968. You know, he would always raise the fist. He always had the afro, the dark sunglasses. And also the Flip Wilson Show is gonna come out in 1970. And this is a comedy show. And again, the program was one of the first TV programs starring a Black person in the title role to become a mainstream ratings hit. Enter Ed Sullivan. Now, a lot of my research entails me having to interview baby boomer aged men and women to get their take on the shows that emerged during this time. Everyone that I spoke with said that they look forward to Sunday nights at 8 o'clock because they wanted to tune into the Ed Sullivan Show. The civil rights movement in a lot of ways was responsible for adding visibility of entertainers on television shows. And of course, the Ed Sullivan Show was gonna be one of the first television shows to showcase the top African-American entertainment in the country. On CBS, 8 o'clock, even my mom still talks about having a slice of cake and a glass of Kool-Aid sitting down watching the Ed Sullivan Show. And this show ran from 1948 to 1971. And it did expose the entire country to a racially polarized nation, because what Ed Sullivan did was he put the best talent up forward, but he did get a lot of death threats because he would touch and shake hands with Black male entertainers. He would kiss Black women on the cheek. He would hug them. So he did get a lot of death threats. And in fact, a lot of people pulled sponsorship from the Ed Sullivan Show. But these are just some of the photos that you see here. Gladys Knight and the Pips, of course, Diana Ross and the Supremes, Mary Wilson, Florence Ballard. You have the Jackson Five, Ike and Tina Turner. You also have Ella Fitzgerald and the Tempting Temptations from Motown Records. So again, to tune in on a Saturday night and see an African-American woman wearing an evening gown and diamond earrings may not seem like a revolutionary thing to us now, but I promise you, in 1966, when everyone else on television was either a slave or a maid, this was revolutionary. Which brings me to one of the passionate parts of this presentation for me, Soul Train. Now the Soul Train show was really for African-American families like a weekly routine. On Saturday mornings, you clean your house while watching Soul Train. That's what a lot of Black families did on Saturdays. And it really brought the family together because the parents could see people from their generation performing and the kids could see folks from their generation performing. But what Soul Train was a TV variety show that prominently featured African-American musical acts. And the best part of it, were the dancers, okay? You had the Lockers, you had Fred Rerun Barry, you had Adolfo Quinones, later on Rosie Perez, some of the best dancers that we know today, Jody Watley, you know, came out of this tradition of Soul Train. And it ran from 1971 to 2006, the longest running syndicated show in American history. Started off in Chicago before moving to LA. It was the brainchild of Don Cornelius. He had this idea to make a Black version of American Bandstand because in the early days of the show American Bandstand, they would not allow Black teenagers to dance on American Bandstand. So he said, we're just gonna do a Black version of American Bandstand. But what Don Cornelius also did was he wanted to present Black culture in an upbeat and exciting way. And he did that. In addition to that, he featured commercials that featured Black hair care products. And again, that may not seem revolutionary to us now, but in the 1970s, it was revolutionary to have someone celebrate Black natural hair on mainstream television. And he maintained control of the show until his untimely death. Here's some photos from Soul Train. So you have Stevie Wonder, Chaka Khan, my favorite, Marvin Gaye, and also Aretha Franklin. I mean, come on, every week you looked forward to who would be featured. But the main thing that you looked forward to was the Soul Train line. And even today, you go to an African-American wedding, the wedding reception is not complete without at least one or two rounds of the Soul Train line. So again, African-American families pulling furniture out of the middle of the floor and recreating the Soul Train line to see who can do it best. Girls on the left, boys on the right. So let's talk about Norman Lear and the African-American family shows that came out of the Norman Lear years of television. So with white audience, the Norman Lear sitcoms offered a lot of discussion on social issues, including race and feminism. And a lot of people had not seen that before the advent of All in the Family in 1971. So Lear and his writing team started talking about social conflict in these sitcoms. They wanted to mix in humor with societal issues on race, and that's what he did. However, there were people that were critical of Norman Lear because they felt as though some of the characters that he actually created to challenge stereotypes reinforced them. So for Black audience, a lot of Black families embraced the Lear shows because they just love the Black representation. They admired the work of the Black actors who brought these characters to life. They love the socially oriented routines and also Black dialect and mannerisms. Handshake, giving someone a pound, giving someone a hug. Those things were not done on television, you know, on a common basis. So it also offered commentary on the state of Black America. And some Black audience did take issue with the fact that some of the characters were a little bit buffoonish, but overall, a lot of people did embrace the Norman Lear characters. So Sanford and Son is a Norman Lear show that ran for 5 years, starring Red Fox as Fred G. Sanford, always having heart attacks. He was a junk dealer in the Watts section of LA, and his son, Lamont Sanford. This was a ratings hit. Everyone loved Red Fox, Black or white. And this ran for 6 seasons. And he did use a lot of edgy racial humor that would not play today. You know, you wouldn't get out of the gate today. But back then in the 70s, there were certain things that you could get away on network television. Good Times. A lot of people have a love-hate relationship with the show Good Times. Some people love it. Oh, they like the theme song and the characters. Every Black man in their 60s that I've ever interviewed had a crush on Thelma, the daughter. But there were also some people who had issues with the fact that the family could never catch a break. Whenever they were about to make it out of the ghetto, something would happen. The lottery ticket would disappear. The promotion that the father had would go away. But the sitcom aired for 6 seasons. It was created by Eric Monte and Mike Evans, who starred as Lionel Jefferson on the Jeffersons. And this was the first time African-Americans are gonna see a two-parent household on television. But that's not because that's what Norman Lear wanted to do. It's because Florida Evans' character, played by Esther Rolle, wanted a husband. They were going to make her a single mother, and she insisted that they give her a husband. And they were raising their children in the Cabrini Green Projects in Chicago. Unfortunately, John Amos had a lot of beef with Norman Lear and the writer. So he left the show because of the negative scripts, because of the buffoonery that he thought Jimmy Walker's character of JJ had. He just felt that it did the race a disservice to have that character. So again, the show starred Esther Roll, John Amos, Jimmy Walker, Bernadette Stannis, Ralph Carter as Michael, the militant midget, and also Janae Dubois, who played Wilona Woods, the next door neighbor. So the Jeffersons are gonna come in. Again, this is gonna be a spinoff of All in the Family. And it's really gonna blow everyone's mind because it was a rags to riches story. And this show ran for 11 seasons, and that's a long time in TV life. And it focused on the lives of millionaires, George and Louise Jefferson, or Wheezy, she was called on the show. And they moved from Queens to Manhattan because of the success of their dry cleaning businesses. But the reason why this show was also revolutionary is because this is the first time a married interracial couple is going to be heavily featured in the person of Tom and Helen Willis. Shout out to Roxy Roker, Howard University class in 1952. Anyway, so Sherman Hemsley, Isabel Sanford, Marla Gibbs, Mike Evans, Roxy Roker, Franklin Cover, and Belinda Talbert, and Paul Benedict are really going to take the show, The Jeffersons, to the next level. And it's been in syndication since its original run in the 1970s. Now, what's happening? One of my personal favorites also aired for 3 seasons on ABC. This was another Eric Monte creation, loosely based on the film Cooley High. This featured 3 African-American teenagers also living in the Watts section of LA. Raj was the main character. And of course, he lived with his mother and his sister Dee. And the character that Mabel King played was a strong Black mother trying to raise her children in a very rough neighborhood. But they used humor to talk about issues facing children living in that neighborhood. And also, of course, Shirley Hempel was featured as the waitress at the teenage hangout Rob's Place. So let's talk about Roots, the miniseries. For African-American families, this was not just a TV event. This was a life event. In January of 1977, one of the most watched miniseries of all time captivated audiences. It was based on Alec Haley's book Roots. And this miniseries really just took everyone's breath away because people had heard about the horrors of slavery, but to see it play out on television, you know, on the slave ship, the mistreatment of slaves, Kunta Kinte, played by LeVar Burton, being whipped into submission to take his new slave name. It really hit home for a lot of people what people already knew. But for Black families, it made you crave that relationship with previous generations. And LeVar Burton as Kunta Kinte really, really just took everybody's breath away, as did Lou Gossett Jr. For his Emmy-winning role as Fiddler, who was kind of like a mentor to the Kunta Kinte character. And then after that, almost every show is going to have at least one Black cast member, right? Welcome Back Kotter with the Sweat Hogs is going to have Freddie Boom Boom Washington, played by Lawrence Hilton Jacobs. You're going to have Ron Glass on Barney Miller, and you're going to have Teresa Merritt on That's My Mama, starring Clifton Davis. In addition to that, we're going to see biracial families emerge on television as well. Different Strokes, again, we love the theme song, so they come on and everyone stops, sings the song. Even if you don't like the show, you like the theme song. But this aired on NBC and then later on ABC for a really long time. The series starred Gary Coleman and Ty Bridges. They were playing orphans who were from Harlem, and their mother was a maid for this rich white Park Avenue businessman. And when she died and left her children orphans, she put in her in a letter that she wanted her boss to take them in on her deathbed. So one of the things that we really liked about this show is the fact that it dealt with issues of racism and classism, things that people didn't want to talk about because it was an uncomfortable topic for a lot of people at the time. It still is an uncomfortable topic for a lot of people. Another biracial cast that will emerge will be Gimme a Break. It'll be on NBC for 6 years, starring Nell Carter, who was a Broadway musical legend. And she's gonna play the housekeeper of a police chief who was widowed, raising his three daughters. But a lot of people didn't like this show, and people in the Black community took issue with the fact that Nell's character kind of mimicked the mammy caricature that they saw previously on the Days of Beulah, the shows that we started this presentation with. Always smiling, always full figure, always single, always ready to put life a limb on the line for white children. That's what one writer in Ebony magazine said about this show. So people again had a love-hate relationship with Gimme a Break. After that, more Black representation. You're gonna see Kim Fields emerge on Facts Alive, Mr. T on the A-Team. Let me move this box. Isaac on the Love Boat. And it's really funny because with the Love Boat, whenever a Black woman came aboard ship, we knew that she was for Isaac. That's how racially polarized it was at the time. And also Venus Flytrap in the form of Tim Reed on WKRP in Cincinnati. Just when you thought Gary Coleman and Ty Bridges had fished the Black orphan lake dry, enter Emmanuel Lewis and Webster. In addition to that, you had the show Benson featuring Robert Guillaume as a butler. In addition to the sitcoms and the funny humor, you're gonna start to see multiracial dramas where African-Americans are gonna tune in nightly to see shows again representing themselves in a positive way. You're gonna see Spencer for Hire featuring Avery Brooks, my personal favorite, Fame featuring Debbie Allen as Lydia Grant, darling. Hill Street Blues featuring Michael Warren, and also St. Elsewhere, Trapper John MD featuring the lovely Madge Sinclair, and LA Law featuring a very, very young, let me see if I can move the Blair Underwood. So again, Black representation, very important for African Americans at the time when you're still battling just to be seen in a positive way. Miami Vice was no different. You're gonna see Philip Michael Thomas emerged as Tubbs, one half of the infamous duo Crockett and Tubbs. They were Miami-Dade police officers, detectives wearing expensive Italian suits. They won Golden Globes for their work. And one of the things that Black men in particular loved about Philip Michael Thomas was the fact that he was the embodiment of cool. He was a police officer, but he was fashion savvy and he was just a cool person. And this show ran for about 6 seasons on NBC. So let's mosey on into the BET Cosby Oprah era, as I like to call it. African-American families are going to really, in the early years of BET, no shade to anybody right now, but in the early years of BET, you're going to see a representation on television that more accurately depicted Black America for a lot of people. BET was founded in Washington, D.C. in 1980 by Robert L. Johnson. In 1983, BET became a full-fledged entity and independent of other channels. So it was its own station by 1983. It featured a news program, Teen Summit, Caribbean Rhythms with Rachel, Live from L.A., Rap City, BET Gospel, and also Mad Sports, which was a show dedicated to HBCU sports programs. In addition to that, the iconic DJ Donnie Simpson will have his own show called Video Soul. Now, people would schedule everything around these shows because of the positive representation. You know, a lot of people have issues with BET now because they play Baby Boy 24/7. But back then they were more diverse in their presentation of what they did. Now, African-American families and married couples in particular wanted to mimic the love stories of Black characters on soap operas during the soap opera era. Angie and Jesse on All My Children, you would have thought they were real people because people just fell in love with this love story. So these were fictional characters. I had to remind my mother and my grandmother, fictional characters. They talked about them like they were real people. Jesse Hubbard was a police officer and also Angie was a medical doctor. And they just had this love story and they were really the first Black super couple on a soap opera. They first appeared in the early 80s on All My Children and the story just went on and on and on. But what they did was they inspired other African-American power couples on the soap operas. So before she was Lisa McDowell in Coming to America, she was Mimi Fry on All My Children, one half of Derek and Mimi Fry, which was another super couple at the time. You also had Neil and Drusilla, and also Malcolm and Olivia. But no one on daytime television compared to Diane Carroll. So Diane Carroll made history as Julia. Well, she's gonna make history again in 1984 as the legendary character on Dynasty, Dominique Devereaux. And she was the first prominently featured African-American character on a primetime soap opera. And her diva-like character basically wanted what all the white male characters on the show wanted, money and power. That was it. And no one had seen a Black woman like this before on television. People were running out buying fur coats and calling each other darling and trying to, to mimic her behavior, because she was just on camera, not just visually stunning, but just the character and the power that she wielded. She was on that show for about 3 years. So in 1984, something happened that would change the history of television forever. And that was the premiere of The Cosby Show. This was a show that featured an upper middle class African-American family living in Brooklyn. You know, a lot of people loved this show because it broke stereotypes and showed a stable Black family and showed Blacks as college educated professionals raising imperfect children. Because a lot of shows, kids were perfect, their beds were beautifully made in the rooms. You know, that's not what reality is. So the show was embraced because of what it depicted. It also produced a spinoff called A Different World, which was a show that featured the lives of HBCU students at the fictitious college called Hillman. So Oprah is going to come into our lives officially in 1986. Her show remains the highest rated daytime talk show in television history. And she features celebrity guests, but she really liked to talk to just regular old folks about race, gender, politics, and always had self-help gurus on there to help you get your life together. But the thing about Oprah is her show was placed on 120 channels, an audience of 10 million people daily, and grossed $125 million by the first year of the show. 30 million of that Oprah kept herself. And she gained ownership of the show and created her own company called Harpo Productions, which of course is Oprah spelled backwards. And she did a lot of shows on racial reconciliation. One of my personal favorites, and one of the reasons why I decided to go to a historically Black college, was because of the premiere of A Different World. It premiered in 1987, centered originally around the character of Denise Huxtable from The Cosby Show. But in the second season, it became a more authentically representative of a Black college, I would say, and featured Jaleesa Vincent, Whitley Gilbert, Dwayne Wayne, all those characters that we fell in love with at the time. But it wasn't just humor. They were using current events and topical issues to engage us on the issues of HIV, AIDS, date rape, domestic violence, colorism, racism, classism, and also the issue of apartheid. Arsenio Hall, 1989, African-American families are going to stay up late at 11:35. They will tune in to the Arsenio Hall show to watch this program, which featured a lot of people. And again, this brought families together because you had the MTV generation looking out for their performers, but then you had the older generation coming together to see some of the individuals that Arsenio Hall would also feature. But in 1992, then presidential candidate Bill Clinton is gonna come on and play the saxophone. And by morning, he will be at the top of everyone's list for the Democratic nomination. And here's some photos from the years of the Arsenio Hall show. You see Whitney and Stevie, Madonna, Tupac, Bill Clinton playing the sax, and of course, Eddie Murphy and Michael Jackson. And after that, again, more Black families are gonna be represented on TV. They will reboot What's Happening Now, 227, featuring middle-class individuals living in an apartment in Northwest DC. Amen, which will feature Sherman Hemsley, set in Philadelphia. He was like a sneaky little deacon at a church and a lawyer. and his daughter, who had a passionate crush on the pastor of their church. Just really funny humor. And of course, Family Matters would come out in 1989, featuring the Winslow family, who, again, a middle-class family living in Chicago, multi-generational household, police officer, dad, mom worked in the newspaper. They originally had three kids, and then somehow little Judy got written out of the show with no explanation, poor Judy. And then they just had the two kids. So this show did talk a lot about family values and life lessons. And then they would play that music in the background whenever they were talking about how, you know, you should be a good person in society. Honorable mentions, of course, would be The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, which featured again, Will Smith's character in West Philadelphia, born and raised, who moved to Bel-Air out in LA with his wealthy uncle, who was an attorney, and his aunt, who was a history professor at a university, just had to throw that out there, in their Bel Air mansion, of course, hanging with Mr. Cooper, Thea as well. The Hughleys, 1998. Again, this was a rags to riches story, very reminiscent of the Jeffersons, a business owner who basically struck it rich and became successful. Kind of the same premise in My Wife and Kids as well. But these two families were a little bit dysfunctional and imperfect, which endeared people to these audiences, the audiences to these characters. I'm almost done, guys. We got about 10 more years of history. Okay, so the Fox Network is gonna be born, and they're gonna start to embrace African-American culture, which will enamor a lot of Black families to the Fox shows. But some Black families were very critical of Fox because they felt that some of the comedy on there was just like neo-minstrel, step and fetch it type of humor. And people had been used to the Cosby, A Different World brand of humor. But Fox is gonna come out and have a large, large Black viewership, which basically made up a fourth of all of the Fox market in 1995. So in Living Color, again, multi-generational households tuned in to look at in Living Color. It was something that we couldn't get away with today because it was totally politically incorrect. but it did feature a number of people that started their careers here, including, of course, the Wayans family, Jamie Foxx, Kim Cole, Takiya Crystal Kima, Jim Carrey, David Alan Greer, and Tommy Davidson. But it also featured the legendary Fly Girls Dance Troupe, of course, Jennifer Lopez, Carrie Ann Inaba, and Rosie Perez was the choreographer of those girls. And they were amazing. And again, sometimes they stole the show away from the comedians. In addition to that, of course, we have Martin Lawrence, again, Detroit-based DJ and his girlfriend, then wife, to become wife Gina, and their friends, you know, just have going through life's changes, making iconic episodes. Everyone has their favorite Martin episode. Mine, of course, is the Notorious Big episode, but we all have our favorites. And a Living Single as well, featuring Queen Latifah, you know, showing individuals living their lives, going to work, you know, not perfect characters, but coming together to try to be positive. Rock, which again is the most underrated show in my opinion of all time, comedy drama on television set in Baltimore, featured Charles S. Dutton as a garbage collector in Baltimore and also his wife who was a nurse. And one of the things that was amazing about this show, in addition to the fact that it talked about social commentary on gang activity, violence, and drugs, they did it live, because these individuals were stage performers. So a lot of the Rock episodes were shot live with no second, third, fourth take. They did it live and it was absolutely amazing. We also have an African-American single father raising his son on New York Undercover, Malik Yoba co-parenting his young son with his ex-wife, also featuring Michael DeLorenzo as Detective Eddie Torres in this legendary undercover New York Undercover show. The Bernie Mac show is gonna kind of do some of the things that My Wife and Kids did, show imperfections in the African-American family. But at the end of the day, you realize that love is all you need. Now for this show, it's based on Bernie Mac's comedy routines. And it's gonna feature him and his wife, Wanda, raising his sister's children. His sister was a drug addict and he kind of took her kids in. And the humor and discipline really brought the show to the forefront, and people absolutely love the Bernie Mac show. But then the WB and UPN shows came out to mixed reviews. Some people loved them, some people hated them and felt as though they were very negative and showed African-Americans in a bad light. But it just depends on what your taste is, right? So you had Sister Sister, Everybody Hates Chris, Moesha, the Steve Harvey Show, Girlfriends, of course, and also the Wayans Brothers, which is a really funny show, Malcolm and Eddie. And then African-Americans are going to start to own and form their own networks, which will give them more autonomy over Black representation for families in the media. So we're going to see BET, BET Her, VH1, OWN, which of course is the Oprah Winfrey Network, Bounce TV, TV One Aspire, Cleo TV, and Revolt come out and basically target Black consumer markets. But the deal is, you want to be able to control the narrative as it relates to Black representation. And finally, Blackish will appear in 2014 on ABC. And this was another upper middle class African American show featuring the father, Andre Johnson, who is a six-figure earning advertising exec, and the mother, Rainbow, is a medical doctor. And it shows their five children, also their in-laws that come in and cause trouble. But one of the things that Blackish is known for is tackling current events and topical issues, which is something similar in the vein of a Norman Lear type of show. You want to talk about what's going on in order to address socio-political issues and also personal issues facing children as they come of age. So that's 71 years of history on African-American representation in the media. I hope you enjoyed it. And for those of you students who are here listening, in the future, feel free to sign up for my course and you will learn more. Thank you for this opportunity. Take care, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Dupree-Wilson, for your wonderful presentation. I know that our students will be interested, very interested, in learning more about the African-American presence in the media. And you do so many innovative things, and we offer so many innovative courses in history. And so again, I would like to echo Dr. Dupree-Wilson's call. If you are interested in taking any of these innovative courses, please make sure you check out history. Thank you so much, Dr. Dupree-Wilson. Now, at this time, I would like to publicly welcome you again and recognize you, Dr. Dupree-Wilson, as the newest member of the History and African American Studies program. We didn't get to do this last year because of the pandemic, and so I wanted to officially do it now. And on behalf of the Alpha Alpha Nu chapter of Phi Alpha Theta History Honor Society, I would like to present Dr. Dupree-Wilson with the Fannie Jackson Coppin Scholarly Achievement Award for Outstanding Scholarly Achievement and Service. So thank you, Dr. Dupree-Wilson, and congratulations. We are so very glad that you are here with us at Coppin, and you are such an integral part of our department. So thank you and congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you. Thank you.
And because we are virtual, the department will see that you receive your award by mail. I would also like to take a moment just to recognize Dr. Larry Martin. And unfortunately, he is not here with us today, but I would like to recognize him just the same. Dr. Martin retired after over 40 years of service to Coppin State University, and Dr. Martin will forever be known as a diplomat like no other. He could make things happen on Coppin's campus that you would not imagine. From spearheading graduation ceremonies to chairing the history department, as Dr. Bankole Medina said earlier, Dr. Martin did it all. But in spite of his many roles and responsibilities on campus, he always kept students at the center. Now, Dr. Martin served as a guide to both faculty and students alike, and like this colloquium's namesake, Dr. Chester Gregory, Dr. Martin made sure that history students were given every opportunity to advance in the field, even if that meant, like Dr. Gregory, driving students to history conferences, supporting students through graduate school, even providing meals and warm familial environments for students, not to mention his legendary pound cakes that could right any wrong that happened. So Dr. Martin, in your absence, on behalf of the Fannie Jackson Coppin branch of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History that all history faculty are a part of, I present the Distinguished Service Award for your continued dedication, commitment, and service to the Department of Humanities, History, and African American Studies program. Thank you for all that you have done and all that you will continue to do for us here at Coppin. Congratulations and thank you, Dr. Martin. Also, Dr. Martin, we will make sure that your award gets to you as well. And now we will have Dr. Bankole Medina provide final remarks and close us out for the day. Thank you. Dr. Bankole Medina.
Okay, I just wanna say to the Phi Alpha Theta inductees and to our faculty colleagues and distinguished guests and to our wonderful, wonderful guest speaker, just thank you. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. And I do need to say something about Dr. Dupree-Wilson's presentation. If you are not aware, you just received a master class in Black media history that would cost quite a bit of money. If you had to go search for it, that's assuming you could find it and pay for it. So this is very, very real. And what a magnificent, magnificent research. I also want to take the moment to say something about Dr. Abner Lewis Moon. She spearheaded this program. She pulled it together. And I'm telling you, let me just share something with you. Dr. Lewis Moon will attempt to tell you that other people are responsible for this wonderful program and how it came together, but that would not be accurate. Dr. Lewis Moon pulled this together. She spearheaded the committee and it's absolutely fantastic how she does this. And she never takes thank you for herself. So we are saying thank you to Dr. Abner Lewis Moon. As we close our Chester Gregory Symposium, we simply ask that you, everyone, join us in elevating the study of history at Coppin State University. If you are a history major or prospective history student, we have countless successful graduates in history. We could mention Breonna Valentine. We could mention Dr. Lopez Matthews. And there's so many we could mention, and I don't want to leave anybody out, but I do want to mention another successful history graduate, Ms. Tanisha Smith. She graduated in 2014 with her degree in history, and now she is working on her master's degree in history at Morgan State University. And she has been working in K-12 education and was recently hired by the prestigious St. Paul's School for Girls in Baltimore, Maryland. So as we move forward to train and educate more students of history at Coppin State University, we will never forget the faculty and students who have come before us. We hope you will join us for our other programs throughout the year and for, of course, next year's Phi Alpha Theta induction and next year's Chester Gregory Symposium. So with that, I want to say thank you to everyone for taking the time to be with us. And we hope that very soon we can be together face to face. Take care, everybody.